pastor at Calvary Baptist Church in Waco, Texas. I had spent the entire morning at our children's Christmas party in a room full of excited children who were all on sugar highs from all the Christmas cookies they had made that morning. We played games, sang songs, made crafts, and even read the Christmas story from the Gospel of Luke. It was such a fun morning. You know, there's nothing like the laughter and singing of little children to really put me in the Christmas spirit. After the party, I took two children home. Their names were Sam and Devon. Well, actually, we went to McDonald's first because I didn't know if Sam and Devon would have any food when they got home. So they stuffed their faces with french fries and cheeseburgers and played in the kids' center until they were completely exhausted. Sam and Devon live in a public housing unit just a few blocks away from our church, the Parkside apartment complex. As we were driving to their complex, I asked the boys what they were asking Santa Claus to bring them for Christmas. Miss Mary Alice, they said, "Do you believe in Santa? We've never gotten anything from Santa, so we don't know if he's real." I paused for a moment, and I said, "Well, do you have a Christmas tree?" And they said, "Oh." I said, "Do you have Christmas decorations in your apartment?" They said, "No, we don't have anything like that. But what we really want are bicycles for Christmas." I got out of my car and walked with them to their apartment, number 22C, and their dispositions from the day had completely changed. Two little boys who had been so excited all morning were now quiet, with empty looks on their faces. Their mom was nowhere to be found when we got back to the apartment. She didn't know who I was, that I had picked her children up that morning, or that I was ever bringing them back. And the one room of the apartment that I saw was completely empty. Tile floor, white walls, and only a small little bookshelf in the corner of the room. Nothing else. I told the boys I had had such a wonderful morning with them and that I would look forward to seeing them at church the next day, and they both gave me tight hugs. I spent the rest of the day literally sick to my stomach over what I had seen. My Christmases as a child involved making Christmas cookies, decorating the Christmas tree, not sleeping a wink on Christmas Eve, and waking up very early on Christmas morning with a gush of excitement to run and open presents and spend time with my family and friends. Somehow I knew that Sam and Devon probably wouldn't get much of that. How was I supposed to enjoy Christmas when I knew that Sam and Devon probably wouldn't? I questioned how God could let these little boys live in such an environment. I thought to myself, doesn't God care about them at all? But then I realized, perhaps, this is exactly how God wants me to feel. God wants me to be disgusted with injustice. God wants my stomach to turn when I think about people living in poverty. Perhaps what would make God even more upset would be if I were completely apathetic toward situations like these, if I left their apartment that day indifferent toward their circumstances, or if I didn't feel compelled to somehow do something to help. But that leaves me to wonder if God is ever disgusted with us, with his church, over our lack of involvement in situations like these. Sam and Devon live in Waco, in one of the poorest zip codes in Texas. However, they also live in a city that claims to have more churches per capita than almost any other city in the U.S. Doesn't that seem like an oxymoron for a city with so many churches to have such a high poverty rate? A recent poll was conducted by the New York Times to find the most religious states in the U.S., and Mississippi was found to have the most religious population of all. 91% of Mississippians say that they believe in God with absolute certainty. And 77% of Mississippians say that they pray at least once a day. However, Mississippi is also known as the state with the lowest per capita income in the U.S. Do you think God is heartbroken by these statistics? Are we as the church truly being the hands and feet of Jesus to those who are in need? Are we loving and serving people who are so precious to God? Now, it's focused on others, we're much too focused on ourselves. Society teaches us to look out for number one, to push our way to the top of the ladder, and to do whatever it takes to be the best. And this way of thinking has slowly etched its presence into the way we view our relationship with God. The question we often ask ourselves in Christianity today is, what can I do to gain God's approval? What can I do to get God to bless me? Now, don't get me wrong, the inner desire to please God is an inherently good thing. It's a holy ambition for us to want to please God. But perhaps our focus in this pursuit is what needs to be sharpened. Because by asking, how can I get God to bless me, I'm focused completely on myself. Our text today, Micah 6, 6-8, starts with a series of questions posed by a prophet who's thinking in the same way. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? These first three suggestions of the speaker are inwardly focused. Can I gain the Lord's approval with all of these signs of my success and achievement? What can I do to get God to bless me? The prophet continues to push the idea even further. Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Now, if we step back from that text, don't you think it seems a bit absurd to offer to kill your child in order to win God's approval? Perhaps the idea isn't as uncommon as we would think, because archaeologists actually find the remains of sacrificed children all the time. What we know today as murder was seen by them as something that might win them honor or glory from God. Now, you and I can recognize that none of these options are going to win favor from God, because our physical possessions and our earthly achievements aren't what ultimately satisfy God. You and I would probably never make such offers to God in order to win his approval, would we? But what if this verse were rewritten in today's Christian culture? With what shall I come before the Lord? Shall I earn his blessing if I go to church today? Maybe if I sing in the choir? Will the Lord be pleased if I read my Bible today? If I put some money in the church offering plate? Perhaps we make similar proposals to God all the time. And again, it's not that any of these actions are wrong in any way. Of course God wants us to attend worship and to fellowship with other believers.